All right, kids, I need you to come. Fast as you can. Up here on stage, right by me. Oh, I'm getting treasures this morning. Who do you think is the most important person that ever lived on this earth? Jesus? Any other answers? God? Moses? You love the baby elephant. What did you?
I love the baby elephant.
I know. Wasn't that baby elephant the cutest? That's why I love that video. It's so cute. So why was Jesus the most important person to live on this earth? Kessler?
Because he made us.
He did. Each one of us are very special and unique. Any other reason why he's the greatest man that ever was on this earth?
He made the earth.
He made the earth.
He made the animals.
Anything else? What did he do, Ian?
He died on the cross for us.
He died on the cross for us. He hung there and all of our sin, it was right on him. Isn't that crazy? And
with a cross?
You have a picture with the cross? That is awesome. Because he was the greatest man because he hung on that cross. And you know, so when we say yes to Jesus, because he is the most important person in our lives forever, even when you're older, Jesus is the most important person. And when we call out to him, we just say, Jesus. And we give him our lives, and he comes and lives in us and fills us. And whenever, maybe sometimes you're scared at night, you just say, Jesus. You say out loud, say, Jesus. Because his name is powerful. It's the most powerful name in the whole world is Jesus. Now, I want to talk to you about this little rubber band. Do you think if I put this rubber band around my ankle and jumped off a bridge, would it hold me? No? Do you think it would break? Okay, so now, how about this? It's a lot of rubber bands. What do you think? Would this hold me if I jumped off a bridge? No? Well, there's like hundreds of little rubber bands. And I did jump off a bridge with this. Not this exact one, but like this. And you know why I did? Is because for me, it was a picture in my mind of Jesus hanging on to me. I have nothing to worry about in this world ever because Jesus has me. Like when I jumped over the bridge, this rope didn't break. I know, look at that. It's hundreds of little rubber bands, and that rope held me. And that's how Jesus is with every one of us, no matter what we go through. He holds us. You know what I did the day after I jumped off the bridge? I jumped out of an airplane. I did. I jumped out of an airplane and I was strapped to a guy. He was the instructor. And you know what that showed me? Is that I couldn't do anything because the guy was completely in charge. And he for me was like a picture of Jesus for us. Like we are strapped to Jesus. And we just have to, when we give our lives to Jesus, we are strapped with him and he is with us. He says that he will never leave us or forsake us. Is that not the coolest thing? Jesus, thank you that you are with us all the time, that you surround us, that you have us, that you hold on to us. That rope is never, ever, ever, ever going to break. And I pray, Lord, that each one of us, children or adults alike in this room today, would know that whatever we go through, you are with us. You will never, ever leave us. We love you, Jesus. Amen. So I want to thank the team that was up here with me. My girls, Kirsten and Gina, were singing there. My son-in-law, Cody. Amy Brown, who's been a friend for years, a friend of Gina and Cody's from Providence, and she's led worship at our ladies' retreats. And then there was Jason, whom you know, Scott, and Zach. I want to thank the team for being up here with me today.
Jesus, I surrender all to Him. I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily. Live. I surrender. I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender humbly. At His feet I bow, worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender to Jesus. I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power. Let Thy blessings fall on me.
Thanks, Amy. I want to start by giving honor and thanks to a few people. Firstly, to God, my Father, creator and designer, who knit me together in my mother's womb with unique gifts and abilities. To God, my Savior, Redeemer, and Healer, Jesus, who rescued me from sin to serve Him with my whole life. To Holy Spirit, my comforter and friend, who surrounds me and lives in me and leads and guides me with His whispers. What an amazing privilege to live in the Trinity, a relationship that can sometimes be confusing for our Western minds trying to figure it all out, yet on the other hand, quite simple if we choose to believe. Thank you to my husband for his love and support, who has always encouraged me to use my gifts of leadership. Our story continues to be unusual. From opposite sides of the world, we've been called by God to do life together. I look forward to how our story continues to unfold, being kingdom builders and kingdom shakers. My children, Gina and Cody, Jamie and Steph, Kirsten and Hans, I love you and I'm so blessed to be your mom. Your love and encouragement is so huge in my life. There's no reason to cry. None. To my mom and dad, you have modeled true commitment and love in a marriage. You have modeled commitment to Jesus. You have modeled to live life to the full, to the glory of God. You gave me wings many years ago and have always believed in me. Thank you. To my mother-in-law, thank you for your so many encouraging words. You know how to make someone feel so special with your words of encouragement. To my sister, my brothers, their partners, and children, you are in my corner cheering me on and loving me unconditionally. With your love and support and your words of encouragement, thank you. To my friends in this room, you are sitting here because each of you play a special role in my life. A piece of the puzzle that is very dear to my heart, each bringing a different angle of wisdom, love, and support. Thank you. To the original leadership team of Morris Praise and Worship Chapel, you are here today except for Harold. You called us back to Canada in 1999, Don and Alvina, Ed and Laura, and Harold and Margaret. Maybe Jesus is giving Harold a view into today's service. How can Gavin and I truly thank you for all that you've done for us? The very best gift that you gave us, instead of a list of expectations to fulfill our job, was to say, be yourself. Follow Jesus and be you. Friends, that is the best gift a leadership team can give to their pastors. We wouldn't be sitting in this building if that leadership team hadn't trusted our crazy idea to move into this Morris Multiplex in 2001. Because they trusted us and gave us permission to try things that were out of the box, because of that, we are here. And it has been such a blessing, us to the town, but also working with the staff here. They have been such a blessing to us. Truly a win-win situation. Hang on a sec. To our current leadership team and board, Jason and Destiny, Dale and Lynn, Greg and Florence, Kevin and Brittany, Gerald, Rennie, Corey, Ed, Dan, and Ed. Please continue to set Jason and Destiny free as our original leadership team did, free to be themselves as they lead you. They will have crazy ideas, and that's okay. Flow with them. That gift of freedom is the best gift that you can give them. As a leadership team and board, we have had overwhelmingly hard processing to do in the past months. Thank you for walking alongside of me. You loved me so much and cared for my well-being. Back in October, Jason especially, he noticed that I was fatigued. Jason, you saw that I was tired. Well, actually beyond tired. You saw that mentally and physically I needed a break. Thank you for initiating my sabbatical in November when you were going through another super tough time in your life, losing your grandpa. Through this whole process of waiting on God and wanting to do what is best for me and the open door, we came to the unusual conclusion that this season was done for me. It came quickly for some, but there was such supernatural peace in that meeting, it was nearly tangible. In the midst of the hard, wanting me to stay, yet wanting to see me released, you gave me a gift. And that gift will yet unfold as the weeks and months go by. The picture that Rennie had shared at our meeting will forever be etched in my memory. He had gotten up early one morning in March and was standing by the window praying for me. He observed a bird jumping from branch to branch, and suddenly it flew away. And he felt the Lord say that I'm like that bird. I've been jumping from branch to branch, doing so many different things at the open door. And now it's time to give me wings and release me into something new. When I started my sabbatical, I would never have imagined this conclusion. I could carry on thanking people all morning. So many of you in this room hold a very special place in my heart. I love you, and I'm so grateful for the gift that God has given me, the gift of you. So how did we get to this place? We don't love change, and I love being here. You're my family. How did we get here? In June of 99, when Gavin and I started full-time with the Morris Praise and Worship Chapel, we would never have written the conclusion of the story in this way. But we are not writing our own story. Jesus is the author of our faith. And all of our stories are being written in a unique and special way. And in that, we need to trust God. Who would have guessed that God would call Gavin into politics and that he would have a passion for community development and pursue that path? He has been called to be a Joseph and a Daniel, someone who brings God's kingdom to earth in a secular world, a missional calling. God's divine favor rests on him, and God has opened many doors for him. Please continue to pray protection for him, as this is not always an easy path. When we live a life committed to Jesus and his plans, we don't always understand how seasons come and go. We struggle with hard life circumstances, but the beauty in all of it is that we can trust God. We can trust the one who holds us in the palm of his mighty hand, and he will always make clear the next season and chapter in his time. I want to share a few things that God taught me during the sabbatical season. Number one, return to your first love. In such a subtle way over the past years, my center had shifted from Jesus to Gavin. My identity was in being Gavin's wife, and even working in the church, I had misplaced my identity. Through counseling that I've done with Dr. Brenda Nash from Restored by the Well Counseling, she ever so gently opened my eyes to see this, and this is why it was so hard for me when Gavin went into full-time politics. Your first love can be your job, it can be your phone. It can be your children, it can be your hobby, your spouse, it can be an addiction. We have a God-shaped vacuum inside of us, and the enemy of our soul would delight for us to fill that with something other than Jesus. There is true and lasting peace when we surrender to his plan and purpose. And until that surrender happens, you will always be looking for something else to fill that space. I have returned to my first love, Jesus. In Revelation 3, Jesus has some hard words for the church, for each one of us. He says, I know your deeds, that you are neither hot nor cold. I wish you either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. Where are you at? Number two, his ways are higher than our ways. Isaiah 55 says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. We don't see the big picture. In Proverbs 16, verse 9, it says that we make our plans, but God orders our steps. Stormy Omardian's book speaks to this, just enough light for the step that I'm on. In Matthew, it talks about not worrying about tomorrow, for today has enough worries of its own. Live for today, embracing the gift that today is. Number three is to be still. It's hard to believe, but during my sabbatical, I learned to be still. I did less reading than I thought I would. I was literally still. I listened to worship music. When I read mostly the Bible. And I rested. Rest. Sometimes I would just sit quietly and be still. I learned to rest. I'm a doer, and my brain had not shut off from planning an event or worship service for a very, very long time. We had taken two short breaks to go to South Africa, and we always took a week or two off in summer, but an extended brain break I had not had in 19 years. It took its toll. I ended up with what some call compassion fatigue. And I think I'm beginning to feel normal. Well, whatever normal means, I don't know. But I think like that brain where the brain was just always going and going, that is not there. And it's just so amazing. Number four, trust. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will direct your path. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Kind of cool when your husband comes home with a tattoo on his chest with exactly that scripture etched, which has been uppermost in my mind for a very long time. I thought you'd like that, Gav. Worry, fear, and anxiety cannot dwell where there is rest, peace, and trust. The renewing of the mind is so huge to combat worry. The Word of God is a powerful two-edged sword. I challenge each of you to read it every day, to memorize it, to chew on it. It is life-giving, and it keeps us on the path of following Jesus. His Holy Spirit guiding us and the written word together is the key to keeping our lives on track. The Israelites received fresh manna from heaven every day for that particular day. This is a picture of what the Word of God is for us. Download an app. Dust off your Bible. Read it. Listen to it. It's not just words. It has the power to change our lives. It is living and active. To change our minds and renew our minds so that we can live as overcomers and in victory. Number five, living for Jesus is all that matters. At the end of my day, when I cross over to the other side, I am answerable to Jesus for only my life and not for anyone else's. Will I be faithful to follow Jesus with my whole life? Make every day count. Wake up every day and invite Jesus to take the reins. We don't know when it's going to be our last day. With the recent Humboldt and Toronto tragedies, we have seen how quickly it can happen that we breathe our last. Please be ready for him if this should be your last day. Today is the day of salvation, is what the scripture says. When I die, I want to see Jesus and hear his words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Number six, don't be anxious. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and your minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true, on what is honorable, right, pure, lovely, admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Keep putting into practice all you have learned and received from me. Everything you heard from me and saw me doing, then the God of peace will be with you. So beautiful. Number seven, stay connected to the vine. When our focus is to stay in relationship with Jesus through worship, word, the word, and prayer, then he orchestrates our lives and we don't have to stress. He will lead us and guide us, and he will make the fruit grow. A very freeing and amazing, amazing place to live. John 15, 1-5. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I've spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. 19 years is a long time. Our children were 1, 4, and 5 when we moved back from South Africa to work full time. It has been an awesome journey. I could tell stories all day long about all the many amazing times, the amazing people, how we've seen God's hand at work so many times in our lives, the baptisms, the testimonies, and we give him all the honor and glory today. He knows why this season has come to an end. What is next? Psalm 90, verse 17. May the favor of the Lord our God rest upon us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. That scripture he gave me a couple of months ago. And that's it. I don't need to worry. Why would I worry? He is going to establish the work of my hands. Part of it is to bake cinnamon buns. I know that. And I know it sounds crazy because many of you in this room can bake awesome cinnamon buns. But there is something, I don't know, way back already, there is something about this. And I am loving it. I really am loving it. So God knows what's going on with that too. I really just want to walk in obedience to what he wants me to do. I'll give it to you later. Absolutely. Good question. Well, just follow your nose. Yeah. How do we move forward as the Open Door family? I've been amazed and impressed by the people that have stepped up in the last 6 months, particularly the worship team. It's just been awesome to see. You know, how else are people going to learn except doing? And it's just been so beautiful for me to see. And the people, each one, just doing such a great job. And learning, and their hearts are just like committed to the Lord. It's just so beautiful. We all have gifts and abilities, and how else do we grow except to use those gifts and abilities? That's how a family works together. And it's a beautiful thing. You are my family. That's not changing. I look forward to loving and serving this church family in a less official role. Because I believe that you do not need a title, a pastoral title, or a ministry career to truly love and serve people. No matter what your job is, we are called to love and serve one another. Whether that is our church family or the community that surrounds us in our day-to-day life. This church family has loved and served this community in a profound way. And I am so excited to be a part of it as this continues. This church community has also loved each other well. Let us continue. Jesus said in 1 John that people would know us by our love. So I don't need to know what my next job will be to know that I will still be loving and serving people. Just like each of you in your own spheres of influence every day. And I will figure out this journey with you as my family, as we together seek to make Jesus' love tangible to people here on this earth. Thank you for all that you've done for Gavin and myself and our family. We love you more than words can say. Thank you. Let's pray together. Jesus, maybe you're here and you have never surrendered your life to Jesus. You have never given him the reins of your heart. Today is the day of salvation. It's just a simple, Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. I surrender my life to you. I invite you to come be the center spot, the Lord of my life. Jesus, I pray that you would take each one of us to a deeper level with you. Lord, that we would seize the day, that we would take every day and live it full out for you, Lord. You are so awesome. You are at work. We can rest in you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this morning. Lord, as your word went forth, I pray that it would bear fruit and the seeds would grow that were planted this morning. All for your honor and for your glory. In your name.
At this time, we want to do something special for Joan. What we'd like to have, what I'd like to have, is every leadership team member, past and present, to come on up here right now. And we're just going to pray for Joan. and get Gavin up here as well. We're going to pray for Gavin and Joan together here. So if we have anybody who's been on the leadership team ever in the history of the Open Door, if you can come up now, current, past, and present, that'd be awesome. It's a wonderful team up here. This is fantastic. I'm going to pass the mic around. Anybody who wants to pray, go ahead. And then, you know, so right now, Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for your faithfulness. That song said, your faithfulness over Gavin and Joan's life, Lord God. Over the many years of their service, Lord God, their sacrifice, God, you're leading them and guiding them. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the memory and for the power and for the legacy of what Joan has done in this church. God, the care. She talked before of compassion fatigue. Lord God, her compassion has poured out of her. Your compassion that you have given her has poured out of her every day of her life for how many years. And we thank you, God, for the amazing legacy, God, the example that she's been to so many of us, the support, the care, the compassion, Lord Jesus. And I just pray right now, as she moves into a new season, whatever that's going to look like, Lord God, your compassion is mighty. Your love for her is mighty. Lord God, your kingdom has good, good things for Joan. I pray right now that you would be guiding her, walking with her, hand in hand. Lord God, I thank you for that right now. And I pray, Lord God, that the example she's given would be inspiring to the rest of us, God, serving, regardless of whether it's as a staff, as a volunteer, as a member of a church, as just a member of your kingdom, God. If we are loved by you, Lord God, you encourage us and you give us things to do and roles to play in building your kingdom. God, I pray that would be the legacy she leaves. Yes, Father.
Lord, we thank you for this couple that has served this community and this church in so many ways. They have sacrificed so much, Lord. And not for their own personal gain, but for your kingdom. And Father God, as you now release them, as our pastor couple, we just pray, O Lord, that you will just flood them with amazing blessings. They didn't serve for these blessings, Lord. They served for your kingdom. But we as a group here, we just ask for your blessings to overwhelm them and to overflow, that both Gav and Joan, that their cups will just be overflowing with the blessings that you have because of their service and their love and their dedication to your holy kingdom.
Lord Jesus, we just come to you this morning, and I just want to thank you so much for sending Gav and Joan to us those many years ago. Thank you so much for Joan's ministry, how she has touched each of our lives. Lord, how she was sincere and honest and deep in her heart. She ministered to everyone with the love she gave, the caring. And when she'd lead worship, it wasn't just playing church. She was worshiping from her heart, and she exhibited that to us. I thank you so much for her, and I just ask you to clothe her and her in your warm blanket of love. Let her know that she has enormous things ahead of her, that you have great plans. I thank you for her. Amen.
God, I thank you that way back then that they came to our call and they followed you here with their little family. We just thank you for each one of them. Amen.
Heavenly Father, I ask you to pour your blessings upon Joan in the way she poured them out to us. Whatever you gave her, Lord, flowed through her and onto all of us as a church. Lord, I ask you that you now just pour those blessings back to her. Help each one of us to bless her and to use the grace you give us to just simply give it back to Joan again. I thank you for what she has done for us, Lord.
I just want to thank Joan and Gavin as a couple. They've changed our lives, and I know they've changed the lives of so many people on their faith journey, and I am so grateful for that. And I also want to thank their family who have come up and worshiped and given their hearts as well, because we know that when a couple is in pastors, that the whole family is involved and there are sacrifices that have had to add. We just want to bless this beautiful couple. And Lord, just keep them in your care, and that your love will continue to be poured out on them. In your name we pray. Amen.
Yeah, God, I thank you also for Gavin and Joan, for their family, Jamie, Steph, Gina and Cody, Kirsty and Hans. Dear Lord, I just pray for your refreshment just to pour over them, dear Lord, that as they are set free, that they would just experience overwhelming joy. That they would just, I just pray for your richness and your presence just to be so powerful in their lives. And I just thank you so much for all that you've given them. And that they have in return just given straight away to other people as well. Thank you so much for your gifts and your riches that you've poured out. And you are so holy and so good. And we get to serve you and worship you. And I thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen. So there's lots of special people to Joan. And I'm going to invite, she has grandchildren at her young age. And she's had many grandchildren. Not all of them are here, but I know she's had many sons and daughters and grandchildren through her home. And so some of the grandkids that are here today, they're going to come up and be a part of this next part of the service here. And there is one more very, very special, important person to Joan that will be making an appearance very shortly. Yeah, I don't know if Joan recognizes the person back there. I think there's somebody really special that wants to make an entry here yet.
Joan, you are something special. A wise young woman once said to me, "You're awesome." I say it back to you, because you drive me bananas. But Gavin, he told me he finds you very appealing.